So we are starting with the living world itself. So in each chapter, we are having some number of questions, and we are going to discuss about the answers of this particular question. So first, we are going to start with living world. So this is the chapter which basically telling us about the nomenclature system, about the naming system of the living organisms. Now the question comes that why this naming system comes, why this thing is necessary? Because in case of all these living organisms, we are actually having different common names for different countries. Suppose apple. In case of apple, we used to Bangla আমরা বলি that is known as apple. If you are going to any other state, that is known as in other language, the name is different. So for each living organism, the name actually differs in each country, in each state actually. So that is why the scientists used to develop this particular scientific name or the nomenclature system or the naming system with the help of which we can give a living thing a proper name. Suppose I'm saying Bos indicus, then we all know that that is basically designating the cow itself. Then if we are saying Lebiodorhita, then obviously that is designating the wrong fish. So in case of scientific name, we used to signify the living organisms with a proper name, but obviously that is having a particular system. So we already know that the most accepted system in case of this particular nomenclature one, that is the binomial nomenclature that is discovered by the scientist Carlos Linnaeus. So in this particular system, in this binomial nomenclature system, we know that we are having two words for each scientific name, and the first word used to signify the genus, and the second word used to signify the species. So in this particular chapter, we are also having the another important thing, that is the definition for the living being, because we know that living things are having some special characters. Previously, we know that living organisms can reproduce, living organisms can grow in size, and these two are the most accepted characteristics for the living organisms. But today we know these two are not the specific characters for the living organisms, because scientists are saying that if you are measuring the height of mountain Himalaya, and after today you are measuring that particular height, and after 100 years when you are measuring again the height of Himalaya, obviously that can be increased due to the deposition of particles. So that means non-living things are also actually growing in size. And the second thing is about the reproduction. So in case of many living organisms are there, like I can give you the example of mole. We know that mole is basically a hybrid of horse and donkey, and they are having the chromosome number of 63, and this mole are actually, they are not fertile. Okay, so they are not actually reproducing any living organisms from them. So obviously they are, that means non-reproducible. And the next thing we can also say that in case of parthenogenesis or in case of parthenocarpy, we also know that from the unfertilized eggs, the organisms are growing in. So that means they are actually not reproducing in proper sense, because we know that reproduction means, or sexual reproduction means basically the union of sperm and the ovum. But in case of honeybees, we know that parthenogenesis is going on, where unfertilized eggs can give rise to the offspring. So that is why the scientists are saying that reproduction or the growth of the organisms are not the specific characters. They are saying that the specific characters for the living organisms are The first one we can say the organization, that is, we know that our the living organisms are having cells, that is the structural and functional unit, and the cell clusters are constituting the tissues. The tissues are constituting the organs, and the organs are constituting the organ system. So this is the specific characterization for the living things. And the next one is we used to respond to the stimuli. So normally the living things, in case of plants also, and in case of animals also, we know that we are responding to the stimuli. So this is the another specific character that normally used to present in the living things. So these two are the specific characters we can say in case of living things nowadays. Okay, so in case of living world, we are also having a section where we are actually discussing about the preservation of the living things, that how we can preserve the living thing. And you all know that preservation can be done in ex situ and in situ methods. So in this particular two methods, we are having different processes, like we can make a botanical garden, or we can make zoological garden for the living organisms to preserve. And we are also making the national forest sanctuaries for the preservation of the animals and plants as well as. And in case of the preservation, we can also preserve the genes, we can also preserve the seeds, we can also preserve the pollen grains. And for that, we are needing gene banks, DNA banks, pollen banks. So several type of techniques are there for the preservation. So particularly living world, this chapter is constituted with this particular section. So today we are starting with the very first question. So in case of the first question, we are having the question that system of classification used by Linnaeus was, four options are there: natural, artificial, phylogenetic, and asexual. So we know that the answer, if we are going to the answer, so anybody can tell me that what is the answer for this particular question?
Record question.
So anybody can tell me about this particular question's answer? Okay, so yeah, the correct option is actually the B one, the second one, because we know that Linnaeus put forward the artificial system of plant classification, which was actually based on the sexual characters. Now, in case of this particular question, we are also having another three kind of classification given over here. The first one is natural system classification. So in case of this particular natural system classification, I can say that here the classification is based on actually the based on the vegetative characters mainly, and which are these vegetative characters are basically permanent, and the organism is basically classified on this particular vegetative characters. Now, why this system has not appreciated? Because this system of classification avoids the grouping of heterogeneous and unrelated group of organisms. So they can't actually classify they can't actually do the grouping of the heterogeneous and unrelated groups of organisms. So this natural system of classification was given by Bentham and Hooker, but this system is not very appreciated. So the third classification system we have over here, that is the phylogenetic system. So phylogenetic system is based on the evolutionary ancestry, and it is basically based on the evolution of life and shows the genetic relationship among organisms. So tumra dekhecho this kind of pictures where one tree like structure is there, and the branches are contained the different species names, and they used to relate with each other with the help of this particular arrows or diagrams like that. So this particular type of diagrams are known as cladogram. This tree-like diagram is known as cladogram. And in this phylogenetic classification system, we use to base on this particular cladogram. So, okay, so students, you can unmute and you can give the answer of this particular question. Okay, so the last one. Hello. Students, you can unmute and you can give me the answer of this particular question. Okay. Anybody who know the answer, they can unmute and they can give me the answer. Okay, so the last option which is present over here
is D.
This particular number one question, that is the asexual system. So asexual system is the classification system which is particularly based on the asexual mode of reproduction of the living organism. Now, the name itself suggests you that this classification system is not proper for all the organisms, because we know that improved organisms are going through sexual reproduction mainly. So we can't group those particular organisms in this under this particular classification system. So in the second question, we are going to the second question. So in the second question, we are having this question that what a taxon is basically. Now, anybody can mute and give me the answer, or what do you think about this particular answer? Because the answer is already written over here. So we already know that the answer is the fourth one, that is a taxonomic group of any ranking. Now, can you tell me that what that particular sentence suggests you? Anyone just unmute and tell me that what this particular answer suggesting you. Hello. 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 Anybody can answer that what this particular sentence is making us understand? Anyone?
It can be. Can I say, ma'am? Hello.
Yeah, sure.
I'm sure. Yes, I was telling that it suggests that it can be a group of like it can be a group of species or a group of families. It can be a group like it can
okay,
be a group
so
of
that is the thing.
A group of any event.
Yeah, so that is the thing. Means we know that the classification system is based on class, order, family, genus, species. So any type of category or any type of ranking is basically known as taxon. Okay. Okay. So next we are going to the third question. So in case of third question, we are having the question that an important criteria for modern day classification. So in case of modern day classification, we already know that we are focusing on the anatomical as well as on the physiological traits, because in case of evolutionary parameters, if we are looking to the evolutionary evolution process or evolutionary parameters, then this particular anatomical and physiological traits are very important. And today we are going to such a kind of research that where we actually used to compare the DNA sequences, RNA sequences, as well as the protein sequences. And this three particular thing, the DNA, RNA, and the protein, these three are the main constituting part of each and every cell of living organisms. So we are actually taking this information about the DNA, RNA, and protein from various type of cells, and those particular cells are actually giving us this particular anatomical and physiological traits. So that is why we can say that the modern day classification is mainly based on this particular two traits. Okay. Now, breeding habit, we already know that it may be asexual or sexual or vegetative. So this is not actually the parameter to show that how the organisms are evolutionary linked. So that is why we can omit that. And the last one, we are having the presence or absence of notochord. So that is also not the parameter, because that is only showing you that either it will be a means it is having the spinal cord or not. That's all. So that is why it is also not a proper parameter. And the first one is resemblance in the morphology. So morphological characters are not actually designating everything. Like in case of morphology, in case of plants, we can say that yeah, they are having some definite morphology in case of a particular species. But in case of human, the morphology also varies. The skin color, the hair color, the eye color, these things are varies. The basic structure remains same, but the variations are there. So that is why the second one is the correct option in case of the third question. So next I'm going to the fourth one. So in case of fourth question, we are having that homeostasis in organisms. Basically the question is, what is the function of this particular homeostasis? So homeostasis is basically a regulatory procedure, or it's basically a self-regulatory mechanism which used to make the body internal conditions constant, because we are having some typical type of body characteristics or internal body characteristics which are actually remain same in all the conditions normally. And this particular environment inside the body itself is regulated with help of many proteins, many hormones, many enzymes. And this particular stable internal environment inside the body, the mechanism behind the regulation of this particular static environment inside the body is known as homeostasis. So in case of homeostasis, we can say that it is basically the tendency to resist the change. So the B is the correct option, because we normally don't accept the changes inside the bodies, because we can't permit that, we can't maintain or we can't actually properly regulate the variable conditions inside the body. And that is why we are maintaining this static condition with the help of many hormones and proteins. So one of the main hormone in case of the maintaining of that homeostasis, I can say that is the thyroid hormone. That is the one of the most important hormones which is regulating our homeostasis in a proper way. Okay, so after this fourth question, I'm going to the fifth one. So in fifth question, we are having the particular question that what is basically a species? So in case of species, we know that the answer is basically it is a unit of classification, because already we know that we are having different categorization in case of plants and animals whenever we are doing the classification in case of them. We already know that the rankings are class, order, family, genus, and finally we are having the species. So obviously it is the unit of classification. It is defining the group of natural populations, and the very important character in a species should be that the members of a particular species can interbreed with themselves. So that is the main criteria for a particular species. Obviously, to maintain the continuity, obviously to maintain the constant chromosome number, because we know that each species is having a particular chromosome number, and if the chromosome number differs, then obviously the species itself going to be changed to some another kind of species. So that is why the interbreeding thing is very important in case of a particular species. So after this, I am going to the sixth question. So in case of the sixth question, we are having this particular question that the high boiling point of water is advantageous to living organisms because. Now, we know that water is basically a universal solvent. Water is having the freezing point of 0 degree centigrade, boiling point of 100 degree centigrade. And water is also having some unique properties, that the density is the most in case of 4 degree centigrade. So many unique properties are there in case of this particular water. But we are having a huge range between this freezing and boiling point. So this particular huge range between the freezing and boiling point is actually advantageous to us. Now, why this is particularly advantageous to us? Because obviously four options are given over here. So the first option is the environment seldom reaches the boiling point of water. So obviously this will not be the correct option itself, because this is not the right thing. And the second one we are having, that organisms can easily boil off enough water to keep themselves cool. So yeah, this can be the correct option, because in case of this particular organisms, we know that we used to do the sweating. In case of plants, they normally used to do the transpiration. So we are actually removing the water. In case of plant, they are removing the excess water, but in case of us, we are actually evaporating the water to obviously make our body cool. So obviously the second option is the correct one, because this particular property or this particular unique property of the water is help us to maintain a constant temperature inside the body itself, and that we know is 98.4 degree Fahrenheit. So the third one, it allows the organisms to spread heat evenly throughout their body. No, this is not the correct one, because not such thing is happening inside the body. Body is maintaining a constant temperature. And the last one, organisms can absorb a great deal of heat before they reaching the boiling point from organisms and population. So we are actually not receiving a large amount of heat, and we are not actually nothing like this is happening inside our body, that the body water is going to be boiled or something like that. We are absorbing a large amount of heat. So this particular D option is also not correct over here. So the B is the correct one in case of the sixth question. Then we are having the seventh question. So in the seventh question, we are having this particular question that if there was no CO2 in the Earth's atmosphere, then the temperature of Earth's surface would be. So in case of carbon dioxide, we know that carbon dioxide is a greenhouse gas, and this particular gas is helping to trap the heat to maintain the temperature. Now we know that today we are facing a problem, obviously. Why? Because the amount of carbon dioxide is increasing due to population, due to the increasing pollution. But in case of if CO2 is not present, then obviously there will be a huge difference in temperature between the daytime and the night time. Suppose in the daytime we are having 45 to 50 degree centigrade or 55 degree centigrade, and in at the night time we are having near about 0 degree or -1, -2 degree centigrade. So obviously there will be a huge temperature difference because there will be no gas to trap the heat and to maintain the balance of the particular temperature of the Earth. So that is why carbon dioxide is necessary, but obviously excess everything is actually bad. So that is why it is creating problem. But if carbon dioxide is not there also, then it will be a problem for us. So in case of this sixth one, obviously in case of the seventh one, the answer will be the B, that is the less than the present. So obviously the temperature will be less than the present one if carbon dioxide will not there. Okay, so next we are going to the eighth question. So in case of eighth question, we are having the practical purpose of classification of living organisms. So what is the practical purpose of classification in case of living organisms? The first option we are having, that the explain the origin of the living organisms. So classification we are not actually doing for explaining the origin, because we know that all the organisms are basically come from the same or common ancestors. So that is why we are not explaining actually the origin in case of this particular classification system. The second option we are having, that is the trace the evolution of living organisms. So we are actually not tracing the evolution, but we are actually grouping the organisms into with the help of their particular physiological and anatomical traits. So we are basically grouping them. We are not looking for the evolutionary relationship. That is another branch of science actually, which is dealing with this evolutionary part. But this classification system is not dealing with this particular evolutionary part. The third one, we are having the name of this living organism. So in case of naming of the living organism, that is another system we know, that is the binomial nomenclature system, where we are basically looking for the particular naming thing, that how this naming things can be done in a proper way. And the last one we are having, that is the D1, that is facilitate identification of unknown organisms. So yeah, so in case of this biological classification, this is basically the scientific arrangement. We are actually arranging a living organism in a proper manner, in a series, in a particular hierarchical series. Okay, we are dividing that particular living thing in a particular group, or we are giving them a particular subgroup. So basically that is depending on the similarities or the differences, we can say, with the new organism. So obviously if a new organism has been discovered today, we are obviously first going to try to find out the differences and the similarities, and then obviously we are going to identify that particular organism with the help of this particular system, this particular biological classification system. So the fourth one, or the D one, is actually the correct option over here. Okay, so the next question we are going, that is the ninth one, that is a system of classification in which a large number of traits are considered is actually known as which particular system. So we already gone through this particular artificial system. So in this particular artificial system, we know that we are actually looking for the sexual characters, we are also looking for the physiological anatomical traits. So we are actually considering many characters or many characteristics. So that is why we means the artificial system is actually dealing with this physiological anatomical trait as well as with the sexual behavior, but not with the morphological part. And if we are going to the morphological part, then we are actually looking that many of differences or various kind of differences are actually there. So the first one is not the correct one. Second, we are going to the synthetic system. So synthetic system is not at all accepted classification system. And the third one we are having, that is the natural system. So in case of natural system, we are basically looking forward to the morphological characters. And in case of morphological characters, there are several kind of variations which we are actually looking for. Like in case of plants, I can say that in case of plants, when we are going to the morphological characters, we are looking for the number of branches, number of axial buds occurring. Okay, apical bud is occurring at which particular position. So various morphological parameters are there which we are actually taking in consideration in case of this particular natural system. The last one we are having, the phylogenetic system. So we already know about the phylogenetic system. So in case of this particular ninth one, the correct option is actually the C. That is the natural system. So next, I am going to the 10th question. So in case of 10th question, that is the most important feature of all living organisms. So here, four options are present. The first one is utilization of oxygen to generate energy. Now, in case of this particular option, I can say that there are actually several kind of bacteria. We know that they are anaerobic, so they don't need oxygen to generate their energy. So the first one, we can say we cannot say that this is the proper option, because the anaerobic bacteria are also generating their energy without the presence of the oxygen, and they are maintaining their growth, reproduction, every living procedures. So the first one is not the correct one. The second one we are having, that is the replication of the genetic information, or replicating the genetic information. So yeah, so in case of every living organism, we know that either mainly we are having the DNA as the genetic material. Only in case of viruses, we used to see the RNA also as the genetic material. But in case of viruses, we know that they are not living things. They are basically in between the living and dead. So that is why we can't take the virus in consideration. But in case of normal living things, we know that we used to replicate our genetic material with the help of a particular procedure which is known as replication. And replication is normally occurring in case of every living organism. The third one we are having, that is the option to produce gametes. So in case of living things, all are not actually producing gametes. In case of asexual reproduction, asexual mode of reproduction, we are having various different kinds of methods, like sporulation or another kind of asexual method. In case of vegetative propagation also, we are having different kind of methods. So it is not always true that all the living organisms are producing gametes and they are doing their reproduction. So the last one we are having, that is the utilization of solar energy for metabolic activities. Now this is not also true, because not every organism is actually utilizing the solar energy for metabolic activities. So in case of this particular question, I can say that the second option, or the B one, is the correct one, because replication is the procedure. This is the most important feature which used to carried by all the living systems or organisms. So in the next question, that is the 11th one, so in case of 11th one, the question is, what is RBE? Now the full form is RBE is also given, that is relative biological effectiveness. Now what is relative biological effectiveness? Now relative biological effectiveness is basically a comparison of dose of radiation between the safe dose and obviously the unsafe one, because we know that UV radiation, excess UV radiation, can cause skin cancer. And that is why this, they are causing skin cancer, because they are mainly regulating the skin proteins. Now UV radiation is actually in excess. Whenever we receive the UV radiation, that is basically altering the skin proteins, or they are creating mutations in the skin proteins actually. So that is why skin cancer is occurring. Now in case of RBE, we are saying that this is the safe dose or safe limit of UV exposure actually. Now in case of RBE, the relative word is there, so that is why we are saying that it is a comparison of the dose of the radiation being studied, okay, with the dose of standard radiation producing the same effect. So whenever we are giving radiation dose in a particular amount to some living organism, whatever the result has been produced, that is actually being compared. Okay, so that is actually being compared with the standard one. So that is actually known as RBE. Okay, so if we know that in case of drugs, in case of any compound which is affecting our biological system, that is having a particular standard dose. Standard dose means that is not affecting adversely our body. Okay, that particular amount of that particular drug or protein is not creating any kind of alteration or any kind of mutation inside our body. But if the dose is obviously greater, then obviously it can cause problems inside the body. So here this RBE means this. So obviously the answer is radiation, because this is basically referring the damages caused by the radiation. So this is the answer in case of this particular 11th question. So next we are having the 12th question, that is, what is true for photolithotrophs? Now first we should know that what is photolithotroph. Now photo means, we already know, that is the light itself, and lithotrophs, or litho, the word litho means the inorganic material. So photolithotrophs are the group of organisms which can make their own nutrition, or which can do their own nutrition from inorganic raw materials. Now inorganic raw materials, it may be oxygen, it may be hydrogen, and this they are obviously they are doing this with the help of the solar energy. And so photolithotrophs, the question given over here, that is, what is true for this photolithotrophs? So we can say that obviously the B one, that is obtaining energy from radiations and hydrogen from inorganic compounds. So this is the correct option for the 12th question over here. Okay, so next I'm going to the next question. So in case of next question, the question is, what is basically biosystematics. Now, biosystematics is a new branch of science which is dealing with the evolutionary relationship of the organisms. Okay, so just now I told that in case of nowadays classification system, we are actually comparing the sequences between DNA, RNA, proteins. So we used to compare the sequences. And why we used to compare the sequences? So that we can find the difference at the protein level, or we can say at the molecular level, that how the organism varies or why the organisms are actually varying from each other. So in case of this particular biosystematics, we are actually going to compare this particular DNA, RNA and protein sequences to determine the evolutionary relationship between the organisms. So in case of this four options, then obviously the last one or the fourth option is actually correct, which is giving you the definition that the classification of organisms are based on their evolutionary history and establishing their phylogeny on the totality of various parameters from all fields of study. So this fourth one is actually the correct answer in case of this question. Okay, so next, I'm going to the next question. So in case of next question, we are having the question that angiosperms have dominated the land flora preliminary because of their. Now, we know that the main improved plant or the most improved plant in the earth we are having, that is the that are the angiosperms. So in case of angiosperms, obviously they are adapting various type of environmental conditions. They adjusting into various kind of environmental parameters. And why they can do that? Because obviously they are having the improved cellular structure in them. So their cellular structure is improved than obviously the other group of plants. We know that other group of plants are also there, like gymnosperm, then bryophyta, pteridophyta, but obviously their structure or their functioning is not so proper like the angiosperms, and that is why the angiosperms are actually surviving or they are actually dominating the land flora, because they are having the power of adaptability. So obviously the first option, that is the A1 is the correct one. So power of adaptability in diverse habitat. So angiosperm can do that with their improved structure. Okay, so next I'm going to the 16th question. So in case of this particular 16th question, we are having that which of the following is not true for a species. Now, the first option we are having that members of a species can interbreed. So obviously that is a correct one. Obviously all the members of a particular species can interbreed. So second, we are having that gene flow does not occur between the populations of a species. Now this is not correct, because gene flow is basically the transfer of the genetic material from one generation to the another, and this is actually happening in case of particular population for a particular species. For a specific species, we are always knowing that they are transferring their genetic material either in form of gametes or in form of seeds or spores, but obviously they are transferring that, and that is why they are maintaining a particular gene flow, and this gene flow is very essential. And so obviously the second option is not true for a particular species. And the third and fourth option, that the each species is reproductively isolated from every other species. Yeah, this is also correct. We know that each species or every species is reproductively isolated. They can't do breeding with another kind of species or another type of species, and if they are doing the reproduction also, then the offspring are normally not fertile. So that is happening in case of this third particular option. And the fourth option we are having, that variations occur among members of a species. So variations are not actually occurring. Variations are not actually occurring in the... actually not occurring in the case of chromosome number. Chromosome number is constant for each and every species. So variation may occur in case of the morphological appearance or the physical appearance, but that is not appearing in case of chromosome number. So that is a very proper characteristic for each and every species, I can say. So obviously the second option is not correct in case of this particular question. So after this, I'm going to the next one. And in the next one, we are having that select the correct statement from the following. So we have to select the correct statement. So first statement we are having, that fitness is the end result of the ability to adapt and get selected by nature. So obviously this is correct, because we know according to several evolutionary theory, that in case of Darwin, in case of Lamarck, everyone is saying that obviously the organism should be fit to get selected by the nature, which is known as natural selection, and that is a part of Darwin's theory itself. So in case of Darwin's theory, we know that fitness is very important, and fitness is actually coming from the adaptation power of the particular species in that particular environment. So that is happening in case of the evolutionary history itself, for in case of each and every species. The second statement we are having, that all mammals except whales and camels have seen cervical vertebrae. No, this is not true. And the next one we are having, mutations are random and directional. This is also not true. Mutations are random, but it is not directional actually. And the final one we are having, that Darwinian variations are small and directionless. That is also not true. Darwinian variations are not directionless. They are having specific directions. So in case of this particular question, I can say obviously the first statement is correct. Okay, so next I'm going to the next question. That is the hemoglobin of a human fetus. Now, before going to this particular question, we should know that hemoglobin is basically a red pigment which is present in RBC itself and helping to transfer or transport the oxygen throughout the body. And in case of this particular hemoglobin, in case of females, we are having a particular type of hemoglobin that is known as fetal hemoglobin, that is occurring only in the time of pregnancy itself, and that is having a greater affinity for oxygen for the than the normal hemoglobin one. So here the question is, four options are here. So first option is, has a lower affinity for oxygen than that of the adult. This is not correct. Next, we are having, its affinity for oxygen is the same as that of an adult. This is not also correct. The third one is, has only two protein subunits instead of four. No, the structure is just as same as the hemoglobin one. And the last one we are having, has a higher affinity for oxygen than that of an adult. So this is actually true, because the fetal hemoglobin is actually appeared, or it is actually produced at around 6 weeks of pregnancy, and the levels remain very high in case of this fetal hemoglobin. And after birth, normally after birth of the baby, that is normally getting down slowly inside the mother's body itself. So that is happening in case of this particular fetal hemoglobin, or it is also known as hemoglobin F. Okay, so the next question we are having, that which one of the following is considered important in the development of feed habit? So in case of this particular question, we are having four options. So the first option is heterospory, then we are having haplontic life cycle, then we are having free living gametophyte, and the last one we are having dependent sporophyte. So the first option, we should come to the first option first. So that is heterospory. So what is basically heterospory? So it is basically the development of seed habit. So heterospory is basically giving us the idea about the production of spores of two different size and sexes by the sporophyte of land plants. So in case of land plants, we know some land plants are there who are having two phases in their life. One is sporophyte, another one is gametophyte. So in case of gametophyte, normally they are having the haploid number of chromosomes. In case of sporophyte, normally they are having the diploid number of chromosomes. So obviously, in case of this particular question, the heterospory is the correct option, because heterospory was actually evolved from the isospory independently by several plant groups. Okay, so in case of this heterospory, this is actually a habit which is coming from the very ancient plant, and this particular habitat which we used to see nowadays, this particular property is basically the modification of that particular property which we actually also shown in the ancient plant. So that is why the heterospory is basically the most important character for the development of seed habitat. Okay, so after this question, we are going to the last one in case of this particular chapter. So in this question, we are having we have to choose the correct statement. So in case of the statements, we are first statement we are having that botanical gardens have collection of living plants for reference. So this is actually true. We are having many endangered plants also which are actually conserved or preserved in this botanical garden, and the scientists used to get the seeds of this endangered plant from this particular gardens and for their research, obviously. And the second one we are having, that a museum has collection of photographs of plants and animals. Now this is not true, because in case of the biological museums, we know that these museums are having preserved plants and animals, samples for reference study, obviously. And they are normally preserved in two forms. Either they are preserved in dry form, they are dried in proper manner, and or they are actually preserved in formalin solution inside the jars. So that is actually the proper one. And the next one we are having, okay, so so this is the answer in case of this particular question. So next, the C one we are having, the key is taxonomic aid for identification of specimen. Now key is actually a taxonomic aid, but that is not for identification, that is again for the preservation of the specimen. And the last one we are having, that herbarium houses dried, pressed and preserved plant specimens. Now herbarium are actually sheets, and we used to obviously maintain them in proper conditions, and in this particular sheets we used to paste the pressed and dried samples in a proper manner. So for this particular question, the second option is the correct one. Okay, so this much we are having for this particular chapter, that is the living world.